support for curious kids is provided by the following: Edison State College, Department of Education, and Florida Gulf Coast University, College of Education.
Hi, I'm Cody.
I'm Riley.
I'm Kyra.
And I'm Callie, and we're the Curious Kids. Welcome to our treehouse.
We were curious about some of Southwest Florida's neighborhoods. How are they different?
And how have they changed?
How are they connected? And some of the places that make them fun.
We can learn a lot from the neighborhoods of long ago.
Like those of the Calusa Indians or the fish houses of Pine Island Sound.
They can teach us about humans and how they adapt to their environment in similar ways, even centuries apart.
To learn about the fishing cultures of our region, we took a trip with Captiva Cruises. Educator Richard Finkel met us at McCarthy's Marina on Captiva Island, and we were on our way.
Heading out towards Pine Island Sound, we passed some really cool beach homes on the islands of North Captiva and Cayo Costa.
We like the historic fish houses, which were built over 80 years ago. Imagine waking up out there on the water. We were curious to know more about the fish houses. So after docking at Pineland, on the northwest coast of Pine Island, we sat down with Mr. Richard to get some answers to our questions.
Why did they build the fish houses out on the water?
Well, back then, this was the place to be. The water was the base of life. Going back to the Calusa, Spanish-Cuban settlements, the commercial fishing, sport fishing of today, it was to people's advantage to be right out on the water.
Do people still live in the fish houses?
No, not today, but they're privately owned, and the people who own them can use them as a fish camp. It'd be a pretty neat place to be out there and fish for a night here, a night there.
Yeah.
Don't you think?
How did the kids get to school?
Well, back in the 1800s, yeah, there wasn't a school bus and there weren't bridges to the mainland. Families that lived on Cayo Costa, they would take a school boat to school. That'd be pretty fun, huh?
Yeah, that sounds funny.
Except if it was very rough.
Was the ice in the red ice house used to keep the water cold or to be melted into drinking water?
Well, neither really. They had a holding tank on the fish houses for water, for drinking water, but the ice was brought in to ice down the fish.
Two centuries before the fish houses, Pineland was home to one of the largest and oldest native Florida neighborhoods, that of the Calusa Indians, who lived there for 1,500 years until the arrival of the Europeans.
Now preserved as an archaeological and historical site by the Randall Research Center, the Calusa Heritage Trail lets you climb up to the top of one of the highest shell mounds, or middens as they are called. Miss Cindy, one of the educators at the center, led the way.
We were high up. You could see a long way from there.
What was the Calusa neighborhood like?
But you know, it was a lot like your neighborhood is today. There were places in the community where people were going about their daily work. Perhaps your work was to be gathering the fish. There were children who were going off to be schooled and taught. There was a great water court here. You'd see canoes coming in. You'd get the best breezes up here, blow the bugs away.
I could imagine being a Calusa kid, looking out there and seeing my friends and family down there. Not so different from me, really. Probably just as curious, too.
Because of all the plants that have grown here, it's hard to imagine that under our feet were layers and 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 more layers of shell and bone and pottery and other things, the debris from life of the Calusa, 30 feet down, huge mound. The mound building here began about 1,000 years ago. And so these shells that were harvested and used in some way by people 1,000 or more years ago.
Clues found here helped to create a portrait of the Calusa's way of life. Wood and twine preserved in wetter parts of the site tell us about the tools and nets they used to catch fish.
The nets were made from different plant materials, such as cabbage palm, Spanish moss, agave, and once it was made into twine, then you would use a net mesh gauge. And what the net mesh gauge does is it allows the holes of your net to all be the same size. So these are three different net mesh gauges. And you can see kind of an example. You'd be wrapping and tying knots, and some of the knots used today by fisher people are the same knots the Calusa developed or used way back when.
Neighborhoods might have changed over time, but some things remain the same. I think that just like us, the Calusa kids would have loved finding this little guy who showed up in a net cast out by Mr. Richard on our way home. It's a puffer fish, and it lives in the seagrass beds, right here in our backyard.
Planting native plants helps attract wildlife, such as birds, insects, and butterflies to your neighborhood.
Aliana's sisters, Aisha and Alexis, visited the Naples Botanical Garden to learn more about these plants and the animals that depend on them.
We met garden naturalist Miss Britt at the Butterfly House, where she looks after resident butterflies. Butterflies are insects. They have 6 legs and 4 wings. We were curious. What could we plant in our backyards to attract butterflies?
Any butterfly garden needs 2 kinds of plants, actually. They need a host plant for the female butterflies to lay their eggs and for the caterpillars to eat. And they also need a nectar plant for the adults to come and feed on. The funny thing about caterpillars, especially butterfly caterpillars, is that they're really picky eaters. So the butterflies usually only eat one kind of, their caterpillars only eat one kind of plant. Like this one that we were looking at, the orange-barred sulfur caterpillar, that one only eats this plant, we call it candlestick cassia.
Is it true that the monarch butterfly is poisonous?
Yes, it is true. The monarch butterfly caterpillars eat a plant called milkweed. And inside the milkweed is a toxic sap. And if you ever break milkweed, you'll see that white sap. And so you should be very careful ever touching it. But the monarch butterfly, its caterpillars are specially adapted to eat that plant and they don't get sick. But other animals that eat that plant or eat animals that eat that plant, they can get sick because the monarchs that contain that poison inside them after they consume it. On the underside of the leaf right here are all these little white tiny dots, and these are monarch eggs. And so the female butterfly will just lay an egg right here, and she'll lay about 1,000 eggs in her life.
What kind of things eat butterflies?
Adult butterflies have a lot of different kinds of predators. Inside the butterfly house, we actually have those little brown anole lizards. They get inside and they try to eat the butterflies. We even had a bat get in here one time and it ate all of the butterflies in the butterfly house. Bats, lizards, and then birds like to eat butterflies too.
So, how do the butterflies get into the butterfly house?
These are chrysalids. So this is primarily how we stock the butterfly house. We get a shipment of chrysalids every week from a butterfly farm that's located here in Naples. Inside here is an Atala butterfly.
The Atala butterfly wasn't seen in South Florida for over 60 years and was thought to be extinct. But when landscape gardeners began to use its host plant, the Kunti, in East Coast Florida neighborhoods, suddenly the Atala was back. A good example of plant it and they will come. We are going to choose some native plants to put in our backyard. Just think, if everyone planted butterfly gardens, our neighborhoods would be amazing places.
Oh, my backyard is a byway for every critter in town. And when I take the time to look, I'm amazed at what I find. The spider's web is glistening in the early morning dew. There's dragonflies and damselflies out from underneath a pile of leaves. Black racer, sleek and shiny, head peers through. Oh, my backyard, your backyard, it's for a beautiful world, it's one backyard. Yeah, my backyard, your backyard, it's for a beautiful world, it's one backyard. Yeah, my backyard.
Changing. People move in, then they move out.
Buildings go up, and sometimes they come down.
When Mr. Thurman grew up on his family farm in the Iona area of Fort Myers, it was mostly all farmland. So what was it like when he grew up?
My father had a farm, and we grew up, 17 of us, and each one of us had our own little garden.
Now that land is covered with houses, roads, and businesses. Today, Mr. Thurman brings his valuable agricultural knowledge to the Roots Heritage Urban Farm in the Dunbar neighborhood of Fort Myers, making healthy, fresh produce available to the people who live there.
The populations in some Southwest Florida neighborhoods change with the seasons because lots of people come here to escape the cold northern winters. We call them snowbirds.
Our region has lots of different kinds of neighborhoods, from older, more rural ones to modern apartment buildings, to homes built next to one another on streets, to homes along canals, and even homes on beaches. But a neighborhood isn't just the street you live on. It's also the people and places you see and visit on a regular basis.
It's the place where you play and make friends.
Then there are the people who help to keep our neighborhood safe.
Yeah, and one of them is Cody's dad.
Cody's dad is a firefighter, so Cody and Jasmine stopped by to see him at the Fort Myers Beach Fire Station. My dad introduced us to his team. Then it was time to check out the fire truck.
So this is the fire engine that myself and my two crew members ride in to get us to different types of calls, fire-related calls and medical-related calls. Would you like to take a look inside?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Wow, this is really high.
Yeah, we get a good view of everything on the road, and hopefully everybody can see us coming down the road.
Next, we learned about some of the cool things that help firefighters do their job.
In high-rises, we carry this hose up to the individual floors because on the individual floors, there's hose connections. Most fire trucks these days also have paramedics, which can provide advanced life support to patients if needed.
We also learned some of the safety tips we were curious about. What did we learn? Number one, if you're outside in a lightning storm, look for some kind of shelter, but avoid tall trees and metal buildings. Number two, don't stay in a group, spread out.
Why shouldn't you go under a tree?
Lightning is attracted to some of the tallest things around. If you're in an open field and the tree's the only thing around, guess what's the tallest thing around? The tree. And if you're under it, you could be affected by the lightning strike.
Next, how to prevent a fire in your home. Number one, make sure your home has smoke detectors and that the batteries are changed every time we change the clocks. So that's in the spring and the fall. Number two, do a fire drill with your family so you know different ways to get out of the house. And decide where to meet outside so you know that everyone is safe. Number three, don't play with matches or leave candles burning unattended.
Help keep your neighborhood safe from fires.
Cody and Jasmine sat down with Deputy Ed Waite from the Lee County Sheriff's Office to get some tips on neighborhood safety.
What would you do if a kid around your neighborhood or your school was bullying you or mistreating you or was just being mean to you?
Immediately, if something like this happens, you want to seek out. Go to whether it's a teacher, a counselor, or some other adult at the school. If it's at home or in your neighborhood, you would want to let your parents know. Sometimes it may not even be directed at you. It may be directed at somebody else that is afraid to say something. And you may be the most important link to get an adult involved in that and allow the adults to interrupt that behavior.
Some other tips Deputy Ed shared with us were, number one, if you're home alone and you think someone is trying to break in, call 911. Make sure you know your address, or if you're at someone else's house, know their address. Number two, if a strange car approaches you in your neighborhood, step away. Do not approach the vehicle. If you can, find an adult that you know. Number three, finally, if someone tries to give or sell you drugs or pills, say no, thanks, and walk away.
Stay safe in your neighborhood.
Safety rules around here.
Being a responsible dog owner is an important part of showing respect for our neighbors. We asked Mr. Colin Glass of Barkbusters to give us some tips on how to teach our dogs not to bark too much.
What you must not do is use the dog's name to try and stop him barking. Because if you think of Rover as a nuisance barker and you go, be quiet, Rover, or shut up, Rover, or anything like that, what the dog does is the dog hears his name and becomes excited about that, so will do whatever he is doing even more. So if he's barking, he'll bark even more. So that's the biggest single mistake people make in trying to get their dog to stop barking.
I was curious to know what to do if a strange dog approaches you in your neighborhood. Kyra had part of the answer.
First, you would probably calmly walk backwards without looking him in the eye because
very
that
good
would make him think you were threatening him.
Yes, so you wouldn't run away?
No.
Good answer, and that's exactly right, and you got that correct perfectly about not looking him in the eye because he would regard that as confrontational.
Okay, but what if that doesn't work and the dog attacks you?
If that ever happens, roll up into a ball and just get as tight as yourself into a ball and don't get up until a grown-up comes to get you. Okay? That's what to remember.
By the way, Mr. Glass is originally from Scotland. Could you tell?
I'm on the beach in Naples by the Gulf of Mexico. Since we live in the coastal region, some of us curious kids were wondering about how our neighborhoods are connected by the flow of water. So we visited Dr. Bruce Neal and his team at the San Mel Sea School to conduct an experiment. We found that science can be fun and adventurous.
Our visit began with Sea School educator Brendan, who had a bunch of coconuts for us to paint. The coconuts were going to help us with our hypothesis.
So think about it. If we put all of these coconuts into the water, how are you going to know if some of them are found or not, right?
So this is a finished coconut. As you can see, we put a number on it so that when people call, they'll say, this is the number coconut that we found on this beach.
Next, we hopped on the bus and headed off to meet Dr. Neal, who was waiting for us on the Sanibel Causeway with a speedboat that would take us onto the Gulf. We put on our PFDs and we were ready to go.
Okay, let's do a little basic geography if we could. What body of water are we on right now?
The Gulf.
Yes, sir.
From Mexico?
No. We're in a body of water called San Carlos Bay. That's the mainland of Florida.
It was important for our experiment that we know our exact location.
Which direction is north? I like that, Riley. North's down here. Okay, where are we going? North. Let's have some consensus. North is somewhere over there. So if north is this way, which way is south?
The other way.
Very good. Which way?
We figured out which direction we were going, and then we were speeding away on the water. It was fun. We sailed past the Sanibel Lighthouse and out into the Gulf of Mexico.
We dropped anchor off Sanibel Island, and then it was time to learn how we could test our hypothesis with Miss Jenna.
What was our question, Jasmine?
Which way the currents are going?
All right, which way the currents are going. Our hypothesis is going to be our guess about which way the currents are going.
We thought they were going south, but to confirm this, we were going to put some harmless dye into the water to see which way it would flow. No way to miss that.
So which way is the current going?
That way.
And what does that mean about your hypothesis?
We were correct.
Right.
The dye was going south. Time to drop off our coconuts and see if they'd float the same way.
What other information should we have about our study?
Time, place, and date.
Okay, time, place, and date. Perfect. So, who has the time?
When we threw them out, all of us, it was probably 11:32.
11:32. Great and specific. We know when it was, we know what date. What else do we need to know about coconuts? Yeah.
That we're in Sanibel.
Perfect, where we are. So we're in Sanibel. Does anybody know a fancy way of telling where on the earth you are? Sometimes you use it in your car, yeah.
Latitude and longitude.
Perfect, latitude and longitude.
So, if one of our coconuts is found, that will help us calculate the distance, and our date and time would help us calculate the speed. But would it confirm that the currents always travel south?
We have a generalized idea where the current goes, but we don't know exactly where it goes because nobody spent the time to study it. So we're doing something totally cool and totally unknown out here.
After all that science, it was time for a swim.
So did any of our coconuts travel south on the currents? Not that we know of, but let's meet someone who did find a Sanibel Sea School coconut.
Hi, Adam. Can you tell us what you found and where you found it?
Yeah, I found it here. We were trying to fish, and it washed up on a shore. And I picked it up, and it was a Sanibel Sea School coconut.
Another coconut released by the Sea School in December 2011 was found in January 2012 on the east coast of Florida in Deerfield Beach. We do know one thing for sure. It's not a good idea to throw anything into the water that you wouldn't want washing up in your neighborhood. Next time you're at the beach, be sure to look out for our coconuts. If you happen to find one, be sure to give the Sea School a call.
Our quest to find fun places in our Southwest Florida neighborhood took us to the Golisano Children's Museum of Naples.
We were so excited. It was our first visit to the Golisano Children's Museum of Naples, and Miss Hallie was ready to give us a tour. What an awesome place. We headed straight for the giant banyan tree.
It was cool inside the treehouse. You know how we like those. Then we were off to the maze in the Everglades.
You never know who you're gonna meet in there.
I like the beach exhibit, especially the giant shell. And if you like fishing, there's plenty of fish to catch.
Everywhere you turn, there's more to explore.
There's even a produce market that's just like a real store. You can buy all your groceries, check them out, and you're ready to go. But it was time to find Miss Hallie. She was waiting for us in Mother Nature's house.
Today, we are in our spring room.
Whoa, this is awesome.
It actually, like, the temperature feels like springtime. It's all warm and cozy.
Well, actually, right here, we are in spring in Massachusetts, in Martha's Vineyard. And the temperature right around springtime is usually around 70 degrees. This spring exhibit is all about feeding baby birds. So what you can do is you can put on a puppet and be a mom bird and gather up some seeds and feed your baby birds. Now we are in our chilly winter room in Vail, Colorado, where there's lots of snow.
Cool.
Do you know what's behind me right here?
An igloo.
And what is an igloo?
Real igloos are made of ice and snow and were built by the Inuit people who live close to the Arctic. This one isn't made of ice, but it's still really cold inside. Next, it was time for fall.
Now we're in the fall room in Vermont. And in Vermont, the leaves are changing colors and falling.
We got busy raking those leaves. It was cool. You can feed the leaves into the tree and they blow out the top. But the most fun part was lying on the ground covered with leaves.
Finally, we stopped in at the World Cafe to meet museum curator Miss Carey. The cafe featured food and artifacts from a particular country. Today they were featuring Thailand.
This is a woman's headdress, and it's from the Akha tribe, which is a hill tribe in northern Thailand. But this is everyday headwear for them. They like to dress themselves up very elaborately every day.
So where did they get all these pieces?
All of our artifacts came from one donor, a woman named Dr. Ernestine O'Connell. She traveled the world starting at the age of 4 with her parents and traveled for many, many years until she turned 85. And she collected all around the world, 145 different countries.
And of course, a cafe means food. It didn't take us long to fix up some Thai food and serve it up. There was even a jukebox. Oh, and did I mention? There was a WGCU Curious Kids room there. We'll visit it more next time. What a great place. I can't wait to come back.
Hi, my name is Madison. I live in Naples, but my family comes from Thailand. Swati ka.
This means hello and goodbye in Thai. Madison is wearing a traditional Thai costume. It's pretty, isn't it?
The Kingdom of Thailand is in Southeast Asia. Just like Florida, one side of Thailand borders on a Gulf Coast, and much of their economy, like ours, comes from tourism and fishing. Most Thai people are Buddhist, which means that they follow the teachings of Buddha. There are a lot of temples, like this one, all over Thailand. Families in South Thailand love to watch Nang Yai, or shadow plays. Huge puppets are moved in front of an illuminated background to tell stories set to music and songs. Asian elephants have played an important role in Thailand's history. They once carried ancient kings into battle, helped with the construction of temples, and pulled logs from forests. But today, most of them are privately owned or live in national parks. People eat a lot of rice in Thailand, as well as lots of noodle dishes like pad thai, made with rice noodles, shrimp or chicken, and vegetables.
I hope I get to go to Thailand one day.
Sawadee ka.
Get up, get out, get active.
Samaria Williams loves to skate, so we thought it would be fun to join her at the Skadium in Fort Myers to do a little skating ourselves.
Kyra and Aaliyah join Miss Betsy at the Farmer's Market in Naples. They discovered some curious fruits they'd never seen before.
Samaria's been skating for about 6 years, but says she hasn't found much time to get out on the ice much lately. I asked her what she learned when she took skating lessons.
I did learn a couple jumps and turns, and then I also did learn, you know, how to go backwards, which was, to me, a little tricky.
Going backwards was definitely a bit challenging. Callie didn't seem to have much problem. She's even got her turns down.
Could you show us how you spin a little? Sure. First thing is that I learned is that you want to step forward and kind of whip your leg around like this.
Cool, and you tuck your arms in to gain speed?
Yeah.
I love skating. It feels so cool gliding around. Well, that's until you fall down. But you just gotta get right back up. I asked Samaria what her favorite part is.
My favorite part about skating so far is probably just being able to be on the ice.
It's a fun way to get some exercise, especially when you manage to stay upright. Uh-oh.
I think I'm getting the hang of it now.
What are some tips that you could give to some kids that are going to come skating?
Some tips I would give to some kids that, you know, just going to come and have fun or even just start learning to skate, I would probably give them the tip to just warm.
It was cold in there, but I got to wear my fun hat and gloves. They don't get much use here in Florida.
It was great to meet Samaria and to skate. I hope I can go back soon.
There was a lot to see, smell, and taste at the Naples Farmers Market.
Look at the herbs.
So many different kinds of fresh produce. Can you believe the size of those carrots? There were also different kinds of homemade foods, like this guacamole, made with locally grown avocados.
Wow. Homemade.
And then there were pies.
Oh, look at all these wonderful greens. Oh. It's spinach and kale.
This is the best
radishes,
table here.
Radishes, Swiss chard.
Oh, wow. I like the purple.
Kale. It's purple kale.
Kale. Oh.
I love the black kale, and this is what I use at home when I make kale chips.
Oh, yummy. Do you make your own special dip for it, too?
No, I actually put it in my food dehydrator and kind of crispy like a potato chip.
Oh, nice.
Much healthier.
Kale chips. That's a new one for me.
Hi.
Next, we met Mr. David Bird.
Hey, what do you have to show us that's different?
We have pomelo. Pomelo is an original. It tastes just like grapefruit, only it doesn't have the acid that the grapefruit has. And they took the pomelo and they crossed it with the orange to get the grapefruit.
Who knew?
It's delicious and sweet. So what's that?
This is called chocolate persimmon or black sapote. And this is where you get your little bit of chocolate pudding fix in a fruit.
Does it taste like chocolate?
It has a slight chocolate taste to it.
Delicious.
It's very mild. I will give you a spoon so you can taste that.
Thank you. It's interesting.
These farmers markets usually pick the produce right before it's brought to the market, so you're not only getting the freshest of the produce, but the most nutritious and what's being grown for the season. It's a great thing to come here, pick up your produce, bring it to your family at home, and enjoy the wonderful taste of what's grown in your backyard in Southwest Florida. And it's a great way to try something different.
That chocolate sapote looked yummy.
It was interesting.
Imagine all those foods growing right here in our own backyard.
I know, and just like the Calusa, we have access to all the fresh seafood from the Gulf of Mexico.
I don't think we'll be building Minnan Mounds, though.
I wonder what people 500 years from now will find from our neighborhoods.
Maybe the igloo at the Children's Museum.
Frozen in time.
We're lucky to have so many fun places to go in our neighborhoods.
I like what Mr. Rogers said. Imagine what our neighborhoods would be like if each and every one of us said one kind word to another person.
I think we can all do that.
See you next time!